Race Day 2017. What an exciting time, what an exciting morning, and I can't think of a better way to start this day off than having a little bit of church inside an XF1 garage. Now, my name's Jason Holt. I'm one of the chaplains with IndyCar Ministry, and we are so honored and blessed to bring you a word this morning. Now, as you're well aware of, you know, today isn't just another day. This race isn't just another race. Indianapolis on Memorial Day weekend is an experience like no other. You know, and I have to admit, I gotta be honest, personally for me, I spent most of my life and I missed the point. You know, for me, it was all about the 500. As an Indiana boy, grown to be a race car driver, all I cared about was making it to this place. Now, as it turns out, God had another plan and he had the last laugh, but I've come to realize that this weekend, it's worth so much more than what I ever realized. You know, in fact, this weekend, it's not about a race at all. This weekend's about freedom. You know, Memorial Day is a moment for us to stop and just reflect on the price that was paid for each and every one of us for our freedom that we have. And it's those countless men and women that lost their lives to provide us freedom. You know, hundreds of thousands of men and women around the world that sacrificed their hopes, their dreams, so that we may be free. And freedom never has been and never will be free. I mean, take a second, look around. We are having church in the middle of a garage in the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, worshiping the God of heaven and earth, and we get to do this openly and freely. In this very moment, we don't have to worry about dying. We don't have to worry about getting arrested. We don't have to worry about the fact that the world hates us right now in this moment. That we can openly and freely in this awesome opportunity proclaim our love for Jesus surrounded by hundreds of people. Something that most people in this world could never do. And it's when you experience a place where there is very little freedom that you can fully appreciate the freedom that we have. You know, we very much live in a world trapped in slavery. In some areas of the world, following Jesus means prison, if not death. In fact, it was just Friday. 26 of our brothers and sisters in Christ were slaughtered on their way to go worship in Egypt. Every day, people are dying for their devotion to Jesus Christ. And this became abundantly clear to me 2 years ago. I had an amazing opportunity to go to India, spend a couple of weeks over there. And it was that experience that taught me how much I took freedom for granted. To go to a place where human life is treated very cheap. To go to a country that had little to no religious freedom. A country where people were not only enslaved by their government, but they were enslaved by their religion called Hinduism. That merely talking about Jesus to somebody can land you in jail. And it all hit me one day when I was standing up preaching one afternoon. And as I was preaching, I looked into the eyes of those who converted from Hinduism to Jesus Christ. And it hit me that these people have sacrificed their lives to not only know Jesus, but to make him known to others. Because when you convert from being a Hindu to a Christian, you are treated horribly. You're cast out. You're written off from your family, your friends. You risk losing everything. And what's so amazing is the fact that even in spite of all the opposition, millions are coming to a faith and finding freedom in Jesus' name. People who are willing to lose it all just for the opportunity to share an experience of freedom with other people. You know, in that moment, I couldn't help but ask myself, what am I willing to sacrifice for Jesus? Am I brokenhearted enough for those that are around me to get out and share the freedom that I found in his name? Have I fallen madly in love with the one who gave it all that it's worth sacrificing my life for. You know, in Luke 4:18, it was a very powerful moment when Jesus stood up in the synagogue. Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus claimed to proclaim good news, this news that we no longer have to be bound in our prison cells of sin, that Jesus came to set us, the oppressed, us, the blind, us, the poor, free, a freedom that wasn't cheap, that cost God everything. We've all been enslaved in prison cells at one point in our lives, whether that's sin, anger, unforgiveness, or bitterness. You know, for some, it's a prison of religion, a prison that, if we're honest, is so easy to be caught up in, relying on our own goodness, our own works, trying to earn our own salvation. You know, religious pride is very much a prison that condemns others for their sin, all while ignoring our own. In fact, it was the slavery of religion that Jesus came and fought against the most. And it was the religious people that he was the hardest on. Meanwhile, it was those who were trapped in the slavery of sin that got his love the most. Jesus had such a compassion for those that were stuck in slavery. So much that he went to the cross for each and every one of us. You know, a moment that earned us something we could never deserve, his grace. In that moment, he initiated a new covenant between us and God, a covenant of freedom that removed the separation and slavery that sin causes, opening up our prison door. We are meant to live free lives, striving and running freely to be the creation God has created us to be. And if there's ever a verse that everybody should have memorized, it's Romans 8:1-2, which says, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit has set you free from sin and death." And that is good news, that we are free to run this race called life with perseverance, that our sin no longer has power over our lives, that we can fully be the amazing creations God has created us to be. Jesus said he came that we can have an abundant life, and an abundant life is a life that we are free from our sin. You know, today I believe that there are some of you sitting in this room that are sitting in a prison cell. There's something in your life that has you feeling in prison. And today God wants you to know that the prison door is wide open, that you're free from your sin, you're free from your guilt, you're free from your shame, you're free from your anger, you're free from your bitterness, that in Christ you are free. And whatever's in your life that has you shackled, know that the prison door is open. All you have to do is walk through. That there is an endless amount of power available just for you to conquer whatever it is you're going through. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." There is freedom as a follower of Jesus Christ. And you have the Spirit of the Lord living and breathing inside you. A spirit that sets the captives free by freedom bought by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. A freedom that's for everyone and anyone who looks to him. Not a religion that says do better and try harder, but a relationship with an amazing God. And this freedom takes an invitation to receive and a lifetime to work out. If you do not yet have this freedom, I would love to share it with you today. So today, as we take a moment, we reflect on the ultimate sacrifice that so many made for our freedom. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, for the one sacrifice of all time that bought us the eternal freedom that we have. Because after all, here's the thing. We are surrounded in a world where people desperately need to know that they're free. They need to know that God opened the prison doors and all they have to do is step through. And for us to call on Christ, may we all say that I am free.